This is a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, made possible by the Friends of SDPB. Pledge your support for quality programming. Call Friends at 800-333-0789 or donate online at sdpb.org. You may purchase this video and many others online at our website. Click on Shop SDPB. And thank you.
This high school activities championship event is conducted under the auspices of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
Ross Arena in Brookings on the campus of South Dakota State University for the final day of the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament here on SDPB2. Good afternoon or good morning to you, wherever you may be watching from. I'm Steve Toome along with J.J. Hartigan. We got our seventh place game coming up in just a moment. It'll be the Cobblers of Rapid City Central taking on the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens, the first of four games here today on the final day of the Class AA Tournament. Great that you could join us here today. And JJ, I tell you what, I think we needed a good night's rest to catch our breath after that finale last night between Washington and Brandon Valley. The final score was an 11-point victory, but don't make a mistake, folks. That game was a lot closer than that.
Yeah, going into the fourth quarter, Washington had just 30 points going into that fourth frame. They score 31 in the fourth quarter, a furious rush to the finish line for the Washington Warriors. And now they've got themselves a date with destiny tonight as they get set to take on the top team in the state of South Dakota, a team that's won 18 straight games, arguably the best top-to-bottom lineup in the Mitchell Colonels. It's going to be a dogfight again tonight. And we're in for another wild day of basketball here in Brookings.
Yep, it'll be Mitchell against Washington. That will be the championship game tonight. The third place game will feature Roosevelt against Brandon Valley. And yes, we are starting a little bit earlier. That's what happens on the final day of the state tournament when it's on the east side of the state. The B is getting underway in Huron on SDPB1 television, and the Class A tournament, because that's out in Spearfish, that is going to get underway 1 hour from now. They're on the Mountain Time, so they'll have a little bit later start for the afternoon and the evening session. Our evening session begins at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time. But let's concentrate on our afternoon session. In a little while, after this game, it'll be O'Gorman taking on Aberdeen Central for fifth place. But first of all, it's the seventh place game, a West River matchup between Central and Stevens. And JJ, the big storyline coming into this game is Margaret McLeod, the senior center from Rapid City Stevens. She's been bothered by a stress fracture in her left foot. She's been playing with pain the last few weeks. She only played 14 minutes yesterday, and chances are she's not going to play. She will start today, but chances are she's not going to be on the court very long.
Yeah, it's an unfortunate injury for Rapid City Stevens, but of course, McLeod heading to USD next season, and I think everybody in Rapid City may be erring on the side of caution. They don't want to really jeopardize her future any further today, and so they will allow her to start in her final game as a senior for Rapid City Stevens, but then head coach Dr. DeBoer is going to take her out of the game and will probably have her sit and rest that stress fracture for the remainder of the day. An unfortunate loss for Rapid City Stevens, one of the best post players in the state of South Dakota at the AA rankings. It's going to be a tough day for Stevens without her inside, but it's one of those things where a young lady has a bright future ahead of her at the college rankings, and they want to make sure that she's healthy heading forward.
Yeah, let's check out the starting lineups. First of all, for the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens, they'll be wearing their blue road uniforms today. They are the number six seed in this tournament. And there you see the starting lineup with Gabby Hafes at a forward, a 5'9 junior, Cheyenne Quinn, a 5'8 senior, Margaret McLeod, the 6'2 senior, will start today, but will not be in the game very long. Katie Claprock, she's headed for the University of North Dakota, 5'5 senior guard, and Alexis Cruz, 5'2 senior, rounds out the starting lineup. Let's meet the starting lineup now for the Cobblers of Rapid City Central. A very young team, no seniors. They'll start all juniors. The Stevens transfer, Lexi Joe Denneke, at a guard along with Chelsea Carmichael. Michael and Taylor Bauer. They are all the guards in a three-guard set. Katrina Melgard is a forward at 5'11", and then Tori Holt, who was in foul trouble yesterday, along with a whole bunch of other players, gets the start at center, a 6'1 junior. There are no seniors at all on this Cobbler lineup. And so this is a game, I think, for the Cobblers, building for the future, JJ.
Yeah, you know, this is a good, talented team. Unfortunately, just ran into two tough competitors on the first 2 days of this tournament. But like you said, no seniors on this team. They'll return all five starters next year. And this is a team that can make a run in the 2012-2013 season.
They will build for the future for both teams starting today. Let's turn it over now to our public address announcer, Mr. Scotty Quass.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. The South Dakota High School Activities Association would like to welcome you to this session of the State Girls High School Basketball Tournament. We remind you that interscholastic events are an extension of the classroom and that lessons are best learned when the proper respect is given to everyone. The South Dakota High School Activities Association, along with its corporate partners, Sanford Health, First Premier Bank, Premier Bank Card, Farmers Union Insurance, Billion Automotive, and the South Dakota Army National Guard, remind everyone that one of the ways of teaching proper respect is through the display of good sportsmanship. So please let your good sportsmanship show during these state tournament games. And now let's meet the cheerleaders before today's basketball game. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd also like to note that cheerleaders from both Rapid City schools are wearing orange ribbons in memory of Takia Snipes' mother, who lost a battle with leukemia earlier this year. First of all, the cheerleaders for Rapid City Stevens. Yeah! Tessa Armstrong. Courtney Denier. Kaylee Evans. Taylor Hagel. Megan Hoban. Montana Heidema. Jamie Jansen, Tara Nielsen, Ashley Probst, Katie Straw, Lexi Straw, Megan Tisch, Andrew Jennings, Justin Peebler, and Isaac Solly. Cheer coaches for Rapid City Stevens are Barb Schmidt and Chris O'Donnell. And now the cheerleaders for Rapid City Central. Cassidy Muller, Kate Bingen, Sydney Harrison, Michaela Frederick, Takia Snipes, Bailey Const, Jason Fuentes, Euro Delanuesis, Taylor Dolman, Amber Lau, Marissa Hall, Meredy Rash, Cameron Barber, and Maverick Greyhorse. The cheer coach for the Rapid City Central Cobblers is Cassie Brewer. And now let's see the starting lineups today in alternating order. For Rapid City Stevens, number 3, Katie Claprod. For Rapid City Central, number 20, Lexi Jo Denneke. For the Raiders, number 11, Alexis Cruz. For the Cobblers, number 25, Chelsea Carmichael. For Rapid City Stevens, number 13, Cheyenne Quinn. For Rapid City Central, number 31, Tori Holt. For the Raiders, number 25, Gabby Hafes. For the Cobblers, number 34, Taylor Bauer. For Rapid City Stevens, number 30, Margaret McLeod. And for Rapid City Central, number 44, Katrina Melgard. Assistant coaches for Rapid City Stevens are Dallas Richter, Sherry Grismer, Brian Madden, Emily Janik, and the head coach for Rapid City Stevens Raiders, Dr. Donovan DeBoer. The assistant coaches for Rapid City Central are Jeremy Noyes, Jim Noyes, Dave Anderson, Kim Templeton, and the head coach, Craig Bloom. Officials for today's contest are referee Mike Pooley, umpire Gillis Stern, and umpire Dave Rogers. Ladies and gentlemen, we ask that you please stand as we honor America with the singing of our national anthem. We remind all in attendance that the proper respect is to remove your cap or hat, face the flag, and stand at attention with your right hand over your heart. Today's national anthem will be sung by Brookings High School senior Taylor Duncan.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rockets reckling, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
And a nice job by that young lady with the national anthem, and we are ready to go with basketball. A West River grudge match for seventh place. These two teams split during the season. Central winning during the regular season 48-38. Then in the, or down the stretch rather, then Rapid City Stevens won late in the year 47-46 in the playoffs. It was a 47-33 victory by Stevens. So 2-1 Stevens at the moment. This one will be for seventh place. It'll be Holt and McLeod to jump at center. Cobblers in the white, Stevens in the blue, and it'll go to the team in blue, the Raiders. Claprock quickly to the paint. She'll have to kick it outside. Here's Cruz, well short. It goes out of bounds to the Cobblers. And JJ, here's a little bit of pressure. Now it backs away, but Stevens really ratcheted up the pressure yesterday against O'Gorman.
Yeah, they're a tough team defensively. They're going to get in your face. They'll play man-to-man defense. You can see McLeod there, even with that stress fracture, being very physical inside early for Stevens.
Ball's loose on the floor. Jump ball will give it to the Cobblers.
And we should point out right now, Margaret McLeod for Rapid City Stevens has played just two games, hasn't really averaged a whole lot of minutes in the game, just 14 minutes in the game last night, but she's the top rebounder in this state tournament with 23 rebounds right now. That tells you how good she is in limited play.
And she just corrals another rebound. She averages over 16 and a half points and 14 rebounds a game, but she has been hampered by that injury, and the shot by Claprock no good. McLeod third on the all-time scoring list as Claprock just hit the deck. Trails Holly Bordewick and Becky Hammond. There's a block by McLeod. McLeod 31 points out of second place. And Coach DeBoer said, you know, it's a crying shame. She could have had a chance at getting into second place behind Becky Hammond. Here's a shot by Quinn off the mark. Holt clears the rebound.
Just to have your name mentioned with those two outstanding scores, though, has to be a great honor for McLeod. But like you said, it is a shame she wasn't able to do more in this tournament. The injury, unfortunate, but it's something she's been fighting and dealing with down the stretch here through the later portion of the regular season and now into the state tournament. Hopefully she'll be able to get that righted before she goes to USD, where she's going to obviously have a great college career. But obviously that's the main reason why they're thinking about limiting her play today. They want to keep her healthy for when she heads down to Vermillion to play college basketball here in the near future.
And we understand that she will not participate in track and field, as the shot goes up by Carmichael and the rebound pulled down by Melgard. And it's going to be a jump ball, no shot, and the ball goes to Stevens.
Yeah, you can see there, we had a great shot underneath the hoop a moment ago from our camera crew. McLeod got her hands on the ball, lost her footing, and went to the ground, and she actually let go of it. And I think that's where the Cobblers coaches were saying, hey, there's no jump ball, but she did have possession of the ball for a good 2 seconds before going to the ground. And Stevens got the jump and had the possession arrow in their favor as they get the ball back.
Hapes on the drive will get a pair of free throws. McLeod, a two-time All-State volleyball player, fine all-around athlete, as Holt picks up the foul. Haves misfires on that one.
Not just a good scorer for Rapid City Stevens either. She's a really good defender. 56 steals this year for Margaret McLeod. She led the team in that category. Just a solid all-around player for Rapid City Stevens. And she's still in the game right now, looking pretty good as she runs back down the court. I think maybe the adrenaline and the fact this is her last high school game probably keeping her on the floor here for the moment.
Nobody at the scorer's table yet. As Lexi Jo Denneke handles the ball. She is a transfer. She used to go to Stevens. Now it's Central. They'll move it inside to Weeks. Oh, she lost it out of bounds. Grace Weeks has been a story. First game, 14.6 rebounds. Yesterday, 13 points, 4 rebounds for the 6'2 sophomore. And she'll no doubt get some more playing time today, as she has been the high point for the Cobblers. McLeod with the shot, and it's good. Margaret McLeod with the jumper. Weeks backs in. Oh, she traveled. And look, the coach, Dr. Donovan DeBoer, he's fired up. You think these games don't mean anything? I tell you what, yesterday there was 2 intense games played yesterday afternoon.
Well, and this being the 7th place game, I think a lot of people can forget about that at times during the state tournament as maybe an afterthought. But this is a game between 2 in-city rivals. These guys have played each other 3 times throughout the year, and I guarantee you these ladies have a lot riding on the line today, if nothing else for bragging rights when they head back out west.
McLeod calling for it, tipped away by Holt and in the hands of Bauer. Bauer scans the court ahead, didn't have anything. Oh, she ran over Claprot, and Claprot's going to get called for the foul. That'll be the first on Katie Claprot. She herself a standout athlete heading to the University of North Dakota. Tipped inside, it was tipped by McLeod. Here's Claprot. Oh, she hits the deck hard, but she'll get some free throws.
It's been fun watching Katie Claprot here over the last 3 years or so. She's really developed into an all-around player for Rapid City Stevens. A true point guard, maybe the smallest player in the state tournament, but she's got a lot of heart. You can see that. Getting up court in a hurry, had a chance for the bucket, gets fouled, takes a hard shot, but now composing herself at the line. She's really been not only the vocal leader, but she's been the leader on the floor as far as what she does and will in games, especially like these when it's against an in-city rival like Rapid City.
She may be the fastest player here. I wouldn't be surprised because I've seen her outrun a number of fast players on the court throughout the last couple of days. Denneke brings it up. Stevens going to drop back man-to-man now. Denneke thought about it. They're posting up Holt. And a nice spin move by Holt in the paint. Central on the board, and here come the Raiders. And we are going to have a foul call. This one against Central. And that will be against Carmichael. And here comes Margaret McLeod out of the game, replaced by Courtney Buck, and a standing ovation for Margaret McLeod and a hug from her coach.
Donovan DeBoer, the head coach for Rapid City Stevens, one of the new up-and-coming head coaches of the Class AA rankings. Just his 3rd year at the helm of the Stevens Blue Raiders, but I tell you what, he's changed the culture for Rapid City Stevens in a hurry. A true class act, and now Margaret McLeod getting hugs not only from her head coach, but from everybody down the line on the Stevens bench. Just a classy moment there for Rapid City Stevens.
Game continues in the bucket inside by Katrina Melgaard. And all of a sudden it's 5-4. This was 5-0 just a few moments ago. And now Stevens will have Buck in the front court. Central going to a 2-3 zone. Oh, nice little jump step by Cheyenne Quinn. Gets around the tall player. Oh, there's Holt wide open. And we have a foul called along the baseline. Boy, Holt was wide open under the basket. Somebody missed her. And I think that's going to be Cheyenne Quinn getting tagged for that foul. That's her first, team's third. Regan Enos in to replace Denneke for Central. Carmichael, the three-point shooter. Off the rim, but Holt cleans it up. Went straight up in the air, and we're going to have a foul on the putback. I think she lost control of that, JJ, as she went up. That's why the ball went straight in the air.
Yeah, didn't really ever have possession of the ball, and I think that's why they're not going to give her two free throws here either. Ball or the foul was committed on the ground, and so now the Cobblers will inbound it from the right baseline.
Kendra LaCroix into the game as Carmichael hits the three. Rapid City Central coming into the tournament launched 336 three-pointers. They can fire from long range and they won't be shy, especially with Bauer and Carmichael. And here's a shot short by Claprot. It goes out of bounds. Oh, a collision over there as it's Cruz trying to chase it down. Carmichael with the block out. And here comes that pressure. And with McLeod out of the lineup, I wouldn't be surprised to see more full court pressure. Oh, mental mistake there by Carmichael. I think she was thinking about shooting it before she secured the ball.
Well, and that pass was kind of a lazy one. It was an overhead pass and a long pass up court, and it kind of took a bounce and just kind of came up all of a sudden.
Melgard strips the ball away from Claprot. Offensive foul called on Bauer. That's the fourth team foul.
On Bauer after the play, almost in disgust, threw the ball back at the official. The official looked at Bauer for a moment, thought about throwing up the tee, but realized this is a state tournament game, a lot of emotion riding here on the last day. They're going to let it slide, but I have a feeling the officials are going to keep a closer eye on that here now in the remainder of this first quarter.
Update from the B tournament early on. Parker leads Edgemont in seventh place, 11-7. 2.5 minutes to go in the first there. That's on SDPB1 television. LaCroix to trigger. McPherson into the game. Cassie McPherson, number 34. She's in the post as Buck fires short on the three. And that's Holt who clears it. Stevens will drop back in a man-to-man after the miss. Oh, somebody missed Carmichael. She's short on the three, and McPherson tips it to herself. Claprot. Oh, has it tipped out of her hands by Carmichael. And a sub in, that's Grace Weeks. She'll replace Melgard, and Denneke back in to replace Carmichael. Sub in, Hapes replaces Buck in the Stevens lineup. Oh, nice defense. It's tipped out of bounds by Bauer, who can't believe it. And it'll be Claprot right in front of Coach Bloom, who has to step aside here. Cruz had to climb the ladder to catch that pass. Just short is Hayes, and Denneke secures it. They're going to go inside to Weeks. Back outside. Three is good. That's Regan Enos. Timeout called by Rapid City Stevens. Central was down 5-0. It's now 10-7. Cobblers on top.
South Dakota Public Broadcasting is able to provide coverage of the South Dakota High School Girls Basketball Championships and other quality programs you enjoy because of the generous support of viewers like you. Please take a moment to express your appreciation by logging on to sdpb.org and click on support to make a pledge.
So far, both teams have attempted 10 shots from the floor. Stevens connecting on two, Central on four.
South Dakota Public Broadcasting sports coverage, I should say, continues next Thursday, March 15th, as we continue our state high school tournament action, this time with the boys' AA championships live right here on SDPB1. You can also find the Class A tournaments on SDPB2 and our Class B tournaments on SDPB3. And our coverage of all the high school championships will be available online at sdpb.org.
Traveling the call. The turnover gives it back to the Cobblers. Stevens applies some pressure, but it's broken quite handily by the Cobblers. They'll feed it inside, but LaCroix steals it. Swiped back by Bauer. Loose on the floor. Enos probably finally picks it up. And Stevens is going to quickly drop back into his zone. A move by Weeks and a foul by McPherson.
Weeks is going to be the focal point offensively when she's in the ball game. Coming into today's play, she has the best field goal percentage out of any player in this state tournament. She's only taken 14 attempts, mind you, but she's made 10 of those. She's only missed four shots the entire tournament, shooting 71% from the field. Pretty impressive stuff.
You bet. 6'2 sophomore, 69% from the charity stripe on the season. I don't know, quite often teams in the 7th and 8th place game don't get too many players on the state tournament team, but I tell you what, if Weeks turns in another solid performance, one would think she may just play her way onto the all-tournament team as a reserve.
It's not necessarily how many shots you take, but it's the effectiveness of which you take them. You can look at SDSU's Jenny Sunderborg. She doesn't get a whole lot of touches during games, but she makes a high percentage of those shots, and that's why she was so successful and ultimately named the all-tournament MVP in the Summit League tournament. Weeks putting forth another performance similar to that. Not a whole lot of attempts, but making the best of her opportunities.
Well, there's a strip by Denneke, but Cruz got it back. I believe Sunderborg also was all first team, all Summit League, as the travel is called.
Yeah, first team all-conference, tournament MVP. Another great year for the senior there, and she's leading her team to the national tournament. SDSU, of course, going to find out on Monday where they're going in that national tournament. And a lot of those players from the SDSU women here around this weekend watching the state tournament. I know a lot of the girls, especially the ones from South Dakota, particularly interested in watching who wins tonight between Mitchell and Washington in our championship game.
Yeah, a couple of former Warriors. I don't know if you want to call them former Warriors. They are Warrior alum, I should say. Once a Warrior, always a Warrior, I think.
Yeah, Coach Melchow said it right. Yesterday was a great day to be a Warrior, and a lot of those former Washington High School alumni in attendance here for the game, and we're expecting another wild crowd here tonight inside Frost Arena.
Courtney McCormick into the game now, number 21 for the Cobblers. It's a 2-3 zone under 10 seconds. Oh, Bauer lost the handle, and they say it went off of Bauer, out of bounds to Stevens here with 5.6 seconds left. Haves to trigger, Claprot only has a couple of seconds to work with, spins, can't get the handle. She got the shot off too late, would not have counted anyway. We're done with one period of play. Our score, Rapid City Central 12, Rapid City Stevens 7. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Welcome back to Brookings, the site of the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. I'm Steve Toome along with J.J. Hartigan. We're done with one period, just starting the second. It's Central on top of Stevens, 12-7. Raiders with the ball, they throw it into the corner, too high for Hafes, out of bounds. Update from the B, they just started second period there. Parker leads Edgemont 17-13 in that seventh place game. Want to wish good morning to all of our viewers out west. As it is about 12:30 here in the afternoon in Brookings, a gorgeous day on the east side of the state. Not tournament weather. Normally you expect tournament weather to be snowy, blowing, but it is gorgeous here today as there is a jump ball after the miss by Holt. And it will stay with the Cobblers. And that good weather hopefully will lead to a good crowd tonight. I would think so, as missed there by Carmichael. Quinn gets it in the front court. Back to Cruz. Oh, she thought about the three, but she'll set up the play instead. Margaret McLeod, the starting center, out of the lineup. She played for a little bit but she will not come back into the game with a stress fracture in her left foot bothering her throughout the season. As there's Cruz, it bounces around the three, no good, the tip out of bounds. It'll go to Central. McLeod did score one bucket in this game. She is third all-time in Stevens history.
Yeah, and Stevens actually had a 5-2 lead at one point, but since McLeod's gone out, they've scored just 2 points. It's been slow going for Stevens since losing their prolific scorer inside.
There's a nifty pass down low to Denneke, who scores the layup. And Central with all the momentum. McPherson shoots the long shot, got it. That's a two.
And that ends the 12-2 run for Rapid City Central.
McPherson is just a freshman at 5'11". Denneke will fire the three. Too short off the window, tapped out of bounds. They say it went off a Raider, Quinn. And it will stay with the team in white. Down low quickly. Oh, it ends up in Milligard's hand. And she was fouled. And they say she was in the act of shooting. And Hayes is going to pick up that foul. I think that Melgard was looking to pass there, and Coach DeBoer is asking about that. Melgard to the line. 52% on the season. No good there. Five-11 junior. Can't get that one to go, and we're gonna have a foul on Holt. That's her second rebounding foul there, and quickly Grace Weeks to the scorer's table. She'll check in. We're gonna see McPherson matched up against Weeks a good chunk of the afternoon, and I think the fans out West River getting a sneak peek of the next few years of interior play for girls basketball for these two teams. Claprock, and she was fouled as she drove to the bucket. And that's gonna be on Carmichael, her second. Quinn to trigger, looking for Cruz. Central now man-to-man. Plenty of time on the shot clock. Hayes, oh, had it slapped away, picked up by Bauer. Weeks turns, ooh, she nearly traveled as the ball is tipped out of bounds off of a Raider. Coach DeBoer looking in stunned amazement.
I think Weeks got lucky there simply because there was so much congestion around her defensively. If there hadn't been so many bodies, I think the officials might have seen that right foot of hers go off the ground just a little bit, but they had the body in the way and the officials didn't get a clear-cut view. She got away with the steal there.
Claprock bottled up along the baseline, has to kick it outside, and there is where Claprock will get it back, and just off the mark on the three as Bauer comes out of the lane with the rebound. Denneke, oh, she traveled. I think it's Claprock who's signaling to the bench that she is a bit exhausted, and she is. She was tugging at her jersey as LaCroix will come in to replace her. So both main players on the bench for the Raiders. Claprock catching her breath at the moment. We'll see how long she stays on the bench. McPherson, the nice jump shot, but it didn't even hit the iron. Travel the call against LaCroix. Here comes that pressure, and now we've got a timeout called by Rapid City Stevens. With 4:49 left to go, it's 14-9, Cobblers.
Well, if you'd like to watch online, you can also get some stats online from our website and more information about all of our South Dakota High School Athletic Championships. Just log on to sdpb.org for complete coverage. And for inside information, programming reminders, results from high school sports, updates from the state capitol, and more, join SDPB online at Facebook or Twitter. If you want to go online to Facebook, you go to facebook.com/SODAKPB. That's SODAKPB. Or follow us online at Twitter at SODAKPB.
Our fifth place game will come about 20 minutes after the conclusion of this contest. It'll be Aberdeen Central against Sioux Falls O'Gorman. Pressure applied in the backcourt. They'll break it ahead with Enos with the ball. And Stevens looking for a trap here near midcourt. And Enos goes to the corner and is bailed out by Bauer. And we're going to have a foul in the paint. And that is going to be on Alexis Cruz, her first. That's the 17th foul against the Raiders, so it's free throws from here on out. Bauer into the scoring column. She's a 70% free throw shooter on the season. Claprot back in. Cruz will get a break. Denneke at the scorer's table. And that one's no good. And the ball tipped around and it ends up in the hands of Quinn. Central back in that zone. LaCroix will test it with the outside shot. She connects on the three. Huge bucket there for the Raiders. Enos goes to the corner. There's the double team. They'll pass it down low, and McPherson tips it out. Boy, I tell you what, JJ, if you know the trap is on, where's the last place you want to go?
Right into that corner. You got to stay away from that right corner simply because the sideline and the baseline act as another defender. If you get two bodies in front of you, you've got nowhere to go. Tough place to be. Unfortunately for Stevens, they weren't able to come up with the steal. The Cobblers will get the ball back here with 4 minutes remaining. Just a three-point game, though, here in the first half. This is quite the ride right now for these two West River teams.
Yep, it has been quite intense here between these two teams that know each other all so well. A cross-city matchup for our seventh-place game. Again, it's Aberdeen Central taking on O'Gorman for fifth place. Tonight, our coverage begins at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time. It'll be Roosevelt against Brandon Valley. Then the championship game, Mitchell against Washington. I'd like to remind you about Kings of the Court, a great documentary chronicling 100 years of the boys' basketball tournament. That comes your way March 18th at 8 Central, 7 Mountain Time on SDPB1 television. Denneke on the inbounds pass. There's Carmichael, the quick three, and she got it. Oh, they give her the two.
Yeah, they'll say her foot was on the line there at the last second. So just a 5-point lead right now for the Cobblers as Stevens gets the ball into the front court.
The drive by Quinn, high off the window, no good, and it's tipped out of bounds. It will stay with the Raiders. Now the officials are going to confer. And they're going to, let's see who they're going to give it to. I think they're going to give it to the Cobblers. Now the officials have to confer again. And they're going to give it to the Cobblers. I think it's the right call. I think one of the Raiders tipped it out of bounds.
Well, I could see the officials there, and I think my lip reading isn't quite as good as it used to be, but I believe the officials there said that that's exactly what they wanted to do. He just pointed the wrong way initially, so the call was correct. They just needed to make sure they were pointing down to the right end of the court.
Denneke on the high pass. Enos can't get the shot away, but she'll find an open lane, and no good, but there's Weeks. Oh, she can't connect. Melgar just throws it up at the bucket, and LaCroix ends up with it.
And that's a play there where Melgar gets the rebound away from the ball near the free throw line, probably needed to bring it out and reset the ball for Rapid City Stevens. Luckily, it doesn't hurt them there after the miss.
Quickly up ahead is Carmichael. Bingo! That one's a three. 20-12, Cobblers.
Courtney Buck with the ball.
Man-to-man now for Central. Claprot will reset. They'll send LaCroix over to the right corner now. 3 seconds left. Nobody's looking at the shot clock. Here's a shot. Good. Count it. It's a two. A two for Courtney Buck.
The official on the far side of the court a moment ago put his hands up like it was a three. The official in front of the Cobblers bench said it was a two. They'll have to check that one here on the next timeout because there are two different signals from the officials.
Yes, there is confusion. They were credited for a three.
The officials are aware that they did give him a three on the scoreboard here, so after the next stop, they're going to check it out.
There's a shot by Quinn, no good. And Melgard brings it down. And carrying the basketball. And now let's see, the officials are going to come over to the bench. The referee who was closest to the shooter, I think, had the best view. And yeah, they're pointing, hey, the official over there signaled three.
Yeah, the official on the near side of the court, just in front of the Cobblers bench, actually had the best look at it. His face and his angle was directly towards the top of the key. And he could see that the foot was, in fact, on the line.
Oh, they're going to give him the three.
They're going to say it's the three, though, after going to the scores table. Interesting.
And that was Courtney Buck. I thought it was a two, but the refs give him three. Claprot on the drive, no good. And we're going to have a foul on the putback attempt by McPherson. And that'll be Grace Weeks picking up her first personal foul. And I'm wondering, those two lines on the court sometimes are very confusing. And I'm wondering, as I was looking at the play, a nice free throw there by McPherson. I think I was looking at the black line instead of the blue line. I think I got thrown off by that too. The black line is the college. The blue line is the high school. It's the blue line that counts. Short. Rebound Weeks. 3 points in the game for McPherson. Six-point lead, Cobblers. They've got the ball, and Enos fires the three, and it rolls off the rim to LaCroix. There's McPherson. Oh, fires an air ball. LaCroix tried to save it and smacked it off one of her own teammate, Buck. Both of them had the same idea, trying to save it, and they threw it off each other.
Yeah, Buck came in just at the wrong place at the wrong time as LaCroix got there first. Threw it back in, thought she was going to get it off one of the Central players, but instead it was right off the right leg of Buck and out of bounds.
Carmichael. Or check that, that's Bauer with the ball. She gets it back from Enos. They're trying to post up Weeks. There they do. Traveled. Yep, tried to take that extra step and posting up and fell to the ground. Shuffled her feet before she fell.
And a little frustration on the eyes of the sophomore right now as she gets back defensively. Very intense competitor there for Rapid City Central.
Claprot wants a screen. She gets it. LaCroix, three, bingo. And Stevens with a nice little comeback here before the end of the half as they trim that lead to 3 points. It's Rapid City Central 22 and Rapid City Stevens 19. All right, we're going to take a timeout, come back, look over our halftime stats. Actually, hang on a moment. We're going to get Coach Craig Bloom to talk to us here before we take the break. And Coach is joining us here at the scorer's table. And Coach, a very intense first half of basketball there, would you say?
Absolutely. You'd expect nothing less when these two teams play.
Now, your team fell down early but made a nice comeback there. What was the key for your team's drive there to recapture the lead?
I think we attacked the basket better. You know, they pressure you so much that if you can't get past that first wave of defense, you're in trouble, and I thought we did a nice job.
All right, what's your team going to have to continue to do in the second half to prevail?
Defense and rebounding, I would say.
Coach, thanks for your time and good luck.
Thank you.
Craig Bloom, the head man for Rapid City Central. His team up by 3 points here at the intermission. We'll take a timeout, come back with more. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Sports Championship is underwritten by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, and by Dakota Bank.
Welcome back to Brookings and Frost Arena on the campus of South Dakota State University. We are at halftime of our seventh place game. It's Rapid City Central 22, Rapid City Stevens 19. And I'm Steve Toome along with J.J. Hartigan. Of course, Brookings has been a buzz the last week or so. The South Dakota State's men's and women's teams going to the big dance. And the men are going to find out where they go tomorrow. The women are going to find out where they go on Monday. J.J., you've been with the women's basketball team as their announcer here, and I mean, it has just been just a magical ride the last couple of weeks.
Boy, you know, it's been a roller coaster of emotions really for the last week for the SDSU women, and really for the men too. Of course, starting getting into that Summit League tournament, then having Steph Pollock, a former AA girls basketball player in the state of South Dakota, go down with a knee injury, unfortunately lost for the season, and then of course yesterday finding out that head coach Aaron Johnston's father unfortunately passed away. So it's been a kind of a wild ride of emotions here in the last week or so for SDSU. But of course, a big day coming up here tomorrow and on Monday for these two teams as they find out where they will go. They've been great hosts here all weekend long at the AA state tournament, and Brookings has really showcased what they can do here as far as basketball is concerned. It's a great athletic town. Their fans are amazing. They've come out in droves this season, and they're going to continue to pack the house here at least for one more night for the AA championship here tonight.
Yeah, it should be a pretty full house here tonight. Of course, the best seat in the house will be right here on SDPB2 television. We'll give you a quick update here from the B tournament. They're at halftime of that seventh place game. Parker leads Edgemont 32-27. In about 10 minutes or so, coverage will begin on SDPB3 television. The Class A tournament that's happening out in Spearfish, they're starting an hour later for both the afternoon and the evening sessions today. And that seventh place game will be between Clark, Willow Lake, and Vermilion. Again, that gets underway in about 10 minutes from right now. Let's examine the stats here as we have them at the half. And the shooting stats are pretty even. 6 of 22 for Stevens, 8 of 22 for Central. Interesting to note, both teams 4 of 12 from the floor in that second period of play.
Yeah, you know, nobody really running away with this game right now. Central had a big lead there starting on a 12-3 run to start the second quarter. But Stevens goes on a nice little run of their own there to end the half, bringing it back within 3. Let's get you some individual scores. The leading scorer in the ball game right now is Chelsea Carmichael. She has 8 points. So far today, she's just 3 of 7 from the field, but 2 of 3 from the free throw line in 15 minutes. The leading scorer for Stevens as of right now, 6 points for Kendra LaCroix. She's 2 for 2 from long distance. Pretty good day shooting for her from 3 as Stevens tries to get back in this ball game at halftime. Stevens shooting just 27% from the field right now, 25% from long distance, and 67% as a team from the free throw line, while Central shooting 36% as a team from the field, 50% from the free throw line, and from long distance as well.
All right, we're going to take a timeout and come back with more. It's halftime here, seventh place game, Rapid City Central 22, Rapid City Stevens 19. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Activities Association Championship is brought to you in part by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, by Dakota Bank, and by Farmers Union Insurance.
All right, welcome back to Brookings. Site of the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. A change in the score. The official scorebook has been corrected, and that three-pointer that was originally assigned to Courtney Buck has now been changed to a two-pointer. So now the score is 22-18. They just made that change a few moments ago. The officials talked to both coaches here right in front of our broadcast location and kind of explained what was going on. There was a bit of confusion on that play.
Yeah, one official actually called it a 3, one called it a 2, and they didn't have time because the play continued to stop and actually talk things over. It wasn't until about actually 2 possessions later that the head coach for Rapid City Central got the attention of the officials and pointed out that they called it a 3. They talk it over at halftime, change it to a 2. So now your score coming out of the break, 22-18 after correcting the 3s. So instead of it being just a 3-point game, it'll be a 4-point contest here heading into the second half.
Interesting to note, for Rapid City Stevens, all their points came from their starters in the first period. All of their points came from the bench in the second period.
And Stevens now leading in the bench scoring column, 11-7 after halftime. But Rapid City Central outscoring them inside the paint, 8-2. And that all partially because of the fact that Margaret McLeod out of the ball game.
Well, she's actually back into the ball game. She is going to start the second half, a bit of a surprise. I thought she was done for the day, and the way she exited when she was hugging all her teammates, you thought, okay, that's it. But she is going to be back out to start this second half.
You got to wonder if maybe at halftime she talked head coach Donovan DeBoer into letting her get back in one last time.
That's going to be a foul on Alexis Cruz. I thought it was kind of strange right before we came out of break. I saw her stretching on the sidelines. And I'm going, no, why is she stretching? I thought she was done for the day. But no, she is going to be in the game here.
Yeah, every indication we got prior to the game was when she finally exits early on in the first half, that would be it. But apparently her senior prowess and the fact that maybe she could get in the ear of her head coach a little bit convinced him, hey, I'm good enough to go one more round here. She gets a block defensively. Now her team with the ball again here with the 7:19 remaining in the third quarter.
They try to get it inside to McLeod, but it's tipped out of her hands. It'll stay with Stevens. Stevens wearing the blue. Cobblers wearing the white today, in case you're just joining us. I'm Steve Toome along with J.J. Hartigan. This is Frost Arena in the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. Claprot gets a screen, a big screen from McLeod who can't. Oh, she does handle it, saves it, swings it around to Quinn. Misfires. McLeod the rebound. Up, she took the extra step trying to maneuver along the baseline. And it will go to Central. A little bit of pressure in the backcourt as Genicke squares off against Quinn.
And Coach DeBoer trying to get clarification from the referees a moment ago about what the traveling violation was, what exactly McLeod did wrong, but the officials wanted nothing to do with it, just simply walked away from the head coach.
McLeod. Hands off to Quinn. She'll post up and the pass out of her reach. Was it tipped? No, it was not. It will go to the Cobblers. Again, a little bit of pressure in the backcourt as Denneke brings it up. Man-to-man for Stevens. Near steal by Claprot. Open jumper, Bauer, no good. Tipped to the bench, and it will go to the Raiders. Good look by Bauer. The shot just not there as Cruz brings it the other way. 6-point edge, Central.
Tori, get over it! Tori! Okay, go get it.
Looking inside, McLeod now posts up. Spins, left hand, no good as Holt pulls it down. McLeod can finish at the rim with either hand. Prolific scorer. Averages almost 17 points a game. There's Denneke. No good on the three. Holt off the window. No good. And Cruz is fouled by Melgard. That's her second. Just underway in the third. Parker leads Edgemont 36-27. At the B tournament. That's in here on Claprot. Sets and fires, connects on the three. Claprot with 5. And it's a 3-point game. Bauer dribble it off her foot. Raiders have a chance to cut it to 1 or tie. And we're going to have a foul called against McLeod, setting the screen outside. Here come the Cobblers. Boy, a pretty aggressive game for the seventh place matchup. Here's Carmichael. That's a three. She has 11. Claprot to the baseline. They'll swing it around to Cruz. Oh, she has a shot blocked by Holt. And then she'll get tagged for the foul as Holt picks up the loose ball. And for Alexis Cruz, that's foul number three. What a play by Tori Holt. And no, it is not the former receiver for the Rams. That is your center for the Cobblers. Spelled the same way, though.
I had to do a double take when I first saw her name on the roster. Didn't know if Tori Holt decided to go back to high school for a moment.
Denneke's short on the three. I just remember I had Tori Holt on my fantasy football team one year. He scored me a lot of points. Always be grateful. Nice move by Claprot. 7 points for Katie Claprot. Bauer up court will find Weeks. Oh, nice spin move in the paint for Grace Weeks, who has six.
Still making a case for herself to potentially get to that all-tournament team here if she continues to play the way she has. One of the top field goal percentages in the entire AA tournament here this weekend.
Oh, Melgard ends up with it, and we'll have a foul underneath as the ball was loose on the court. And Cruz just picks up her fourth personal foul. LaCroix will check in, and here comes McLeod back into the game. So obviously that leg not bothering her at least as much. She is limping a little bit. You can notice that when she moves. She's posting up against Weeks. Here's Carmichael, and she'll connect. That's another three. She's got 14.
Just like that, it's a 9-point lead for Rapid City Central.
And Central sink back into that zone, trying to bottle up McLeod. Bullet pass. Oh, McPherson has it stolen away by Bauer. She was so concerned about handling the loose ball, she didn't notice Bauer slipping in behind her, and Bauer takes the ball away. Carmichael to the outside. McLeod the near steal. Weeks blocked by McLeod. Weeks complained to the referee that she was fouled. No call. And here come the Raiders. Quinn thinks about the shot, backs up. And now she'll fire the long three and hit. Wow, that was an NBA range three.
Yeah, Denneke sagged off just a little bit defensively, and that allowed the separation Quinn needed to launch the three. She still had the hand in her face, but got the good look there in the right wing and knocked it down.
Oh my gosh, Melgard hit the deck hard as Claprot ran right into her. And quickly, we're gonna have a sub to the bench. It's gonna be McCormick, and Melgard is shaken up. Let's hope she can shake it off and come back. She got hit square in the chest by a charging Claprot.
Well, she was trying to set the screen on the play. Claprot was following the girl she was defending, and it was just one of those tough luck plays where they ran into each other hard enough to knock the wind out of Melgard. She's gonna have to check out of the ball game, trying to catch her breath right now, but I think she's more concerned that she just can't breathe at the moment.
Misfires this Carmichael, and we're gonna have a foul.
This game has gotten very physical.
Jump ball between Weeks and Margaret McLeod there. Yeah, you're right. It is. They're fighting out there. They're not just going through the motions. And that's McCormick hits it too. Her first bucket.
These two teams played a couple of years ago in Huron at the AA state tournament, and they had an interesting matchup similar to this. Very physical, high octane. There's a lot riding on this game, more than just the seventh place game. We touched on it a bit earlier. These two teams have played each other three times during the regular season and into the districts. This one has city pride. It has, you know, a lot more riding on it than just a seventh place finish here at the AA state championship. These two teams want to win and they want to beat each other no matter the cost.
Enos in and Carmichael out for the Cobblers. New shot clock, Claprot bottled up along the baseline, loses her footing, loses the ball. Here comes Bauer. The drive by Denneke runs into McLeod, who gets the foul. And it's going to be charging against Denneke. Coach Bloom can't believe it. McLeod held her ground.
Wow.
There was a couple of defenders there, McLeod being the main one. She'll finish at the bucket.
She's so strong when she goes inside with her left hand, that quick spin move from the right baseline. She gets that quick first stutter step going left, then right. Gets the shot off the glass. Just a beautiful shot there from McLeod.
I'll tell you what, that's when you're a post player and you can spin off either shoulder and finish at the rim with either hand, that's a huge weapon in your arsenal. McLeod has used it effectively for many years to score a lot of points for the Raiders. Oh, here's Weeks. And she gets bottled up and fouled along the baseline, right under the basket. Let's see who collects that foul.
And that's a play where Claprot, who gets the foul there, by the way, maybe has her speed as a disadvantage that time. She was coming in from the right wing, got inside the lane as the help defender quickly, but wasn't able to slow down because she came in so fast, and her body just had her momentum carry into the person she was trying to defend, and the foul was called because of that contact.
Yeah, she got in there so quickly, but the players in front of her came to a dead stop, and she just couldn't stop in time, as Weeks now has 7 points. She's 3 of 3 at the line today. Got them both. 8 points for Grace Weeks. And let's see the scores table. Checking on something. They're just double checking on who the foul was on. And they said it was on number 3 and there would be 2 shots. So Claprot remains on the floor with 3 fouls. She has the ball. Central sinks back to the zone. Here's the shot, no good by Claprot. Denneke secures it, gets it back to Bauer. Bauer chased by Claprot. Trying to post up Weeks. She's calling for it. There she gets it. Up, she traveled. Changed her mind at mid-move. Turns it over. It'll be LaCroix to bring it up. She'll run the point now for the Raiders. Kicks it out to Haves, who, oh, she had a shot if she could have held on to it. Stevens will move it around. McLeod underneath, got it. Pure strength there for Margaret McLeod. Got good position, and there's a turnover in the backcourt against Central. Stevens down by 5. They got a chance to cut into it. Holt in, Weeks out for the Cobblers.
Stevens went on a big run to end the second quarter, trying to do that again here in the third to get back in the ballgame. Right now, just a 5-point game. They can get a 3 here quickly before the end of the third quarter. That makes the fourth quarter very tight heading into that final quarter of play between these two in-city rivals.
LaCroix has to give it away.
LaCroix's the big 3-point shooter.
High arcing shot, it's gonna be short. It's gonna be tipped out of bounds. And it will go to Central. Carmichael, hurry up. Well, we can't get Carmichael to the scorer's table quickly enough.
Might have heard the coaching staff for Central there just a moment ago saying that we're going to try for our last shot here. It's a 6-point lead right now for Central. 36-30 your score.
Under 10 seconds. Denneke swings it to Bauer. In the paint, it's slapped away. Bauer, she'll get a shot. It's blocked. And we're done with 3 periods of play. Our score, Rapid City Central, 36. Rapid City Stevens. 6:30. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Back underway here, fourth period just started. Cobblers up by six, Raiders with the basketball. 36-30 is our score. They'll lob it to McLeod, who's seen a lot of playing time here in the second half. Claprot, short on the three. Loose ball to Bauer. Denneke in the front court, into the paint. And she lost the handle and traveled.
Yeah, Margaret McLeod, a nice story today for Rapid City Stevens. Of course, in the Rapid City newspaper this morning, we find out that the coaching staff last night told the reporter that because of the stress fracture, McLeod would not be able to play more than just starting today. But after getting out and stretching things out, McLeod apparently feeling good enough here in the second half to continue her play, which is a nice surprise for Stevens and an added bonus inside. She's really helped out getting Stevens back within the six here in this second half.
Still 10 seconds on the shot clock. Claprot lobs it in. McLeod over a triple team. He is going to get some free throws. Let's see who catches that. That'll be Melgard, her third. And McLeod, for the first time today, goes to the free throw line. They're underway at the A tournament. Just started between Clark Willow Lake and Vermilion. Misfires on that one. Meanwhile, at the B, it's 53-31, Parker over Edgemont. Misfired on them both. That game late in the third period over at the B with Parker in the 22-point advantage. Holt spins, partially blocked. Melgard can't connect. Rebound on the floor, picked up by Cruz, who gives way to Hayes. Hayes has a teammate, it's Claprot. But she traveled. Boy, Claprot had a chance for a layup there. Hayes was trying to get the ball to her, but just lost control. Missed opportunity for the Raiders. And now they'll apply the pressure. Melgard in trouble, throws it into the open court. Timeout called by Rapid City Central. And that was a good use of a timeout. That might have been an over and back.
Big time timeout there. Now it's 6:28 remaining, just a 6-point game here in our seventh place game today between the two Rapid City schools. If you'd like to purchase a DVD copy of any of your high school girls basketball championships, you can call us at 1-800-456-0766. Your DVD copies are $19.95 plus a $5 shipping and handling fee. And by the way, if you're a member of our Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, your shipping is free. Again, that number, 800-456-0766. Or you can log online to sdpb.org and click on the shopping cart for your copy of any of the State Girls High School Championship games.
I don't know if I've ever seen a stat line quite like this before. In the first period, Rapid City Stevens, all their points scored by the starters. In the second period, all their points scored by the reserves. In the third period, all their points scored by their starters. The Cobblers outscored the Raiders 14-12 in that third period. Carmichael leading the way with 14 points for the Cobblers. 7 points for Claprot to lead the way for the Raiders.
Central has shot well from three today. They try to get it inside there, but a steal for Claprot.
Yep, she's going to be fouled. And I think that is going to be Carmichael. Do the one and one. Or no, not the one and one yet. That's going to be fourth foul on Carmichael. Raiders with 16 fouls. Cobblers now with five. And Regan Ian is checking in, number 30 for Central. Quinn to trigger along the baseline. Gets it outside to McLeod.
Tell you what, this has been a great game to start our final day here at the AA State Championship, and a big play there for Quinn. They call her Dr. Quinn. She's got the medicine there. Gets the bucket and has a chance to bring her team back within three.
Melgar just picks up her fourth personal foul. for the Cobblers. LaCroix in, Cruz out. Cruz out there for a moment. She has four fouls in the game for the Raiders. And Quinn to the front line for the first time today. 7 points in the game so far. Make it eight. And it's a three-point game. A lot of time left, and here comes the pressure. Cross court to Enos in the front court. Gets it back to the point guard, Bauer. They're trying to post up Holt. Now they'll get it to Melgar. The mid-range jumper is short, and the rebound swatted out of the air by McLeod. Up ahead, Claprod on the release. And she's going to be fouled by Bauer. Oh, Coach DeBoer wanted the intentional foul, and he didn't get it.
Claprod actually got called for a flagrant foul on an identical play yesterday. She was the defender. This time she had the ball in her hand, got fouled hard as she went up. They did go after the ball rather than fouling the body, so it will not be a flagrant call here. But Claprod took a hard tumble to the ground, actually smacking the left side of her face to the floor as she went to the floor, but able to compose herself here, unable, though, to make the first free throw attempt.
You can see Coach DeBoer standing in the background there, right in front of the Raider bench. Got that one. She's got 8 points, does Claprod. Chris, her older brother, wrestles for the University of Iowa. The freshman there, one of the best to ever step on the mat in the state of South Dakota. Shot short. And we're going to have a foul on the rebound attempt.
Yeah, the Claprod family, a very athletic family. And oh my goodness, a foul actually called on Central. And the Cobblers coaching staff in shock. They can't believe it. They thought it was going to be a foul called on Quinn for Stevens. Instead, that's going to be the eighth team foul called on Rapid City Central. Coach Blom over here trying to get the explanation from the coaching staff. But right now, Quinn heading to the line for Stevens here for a chance to get another point on the board here in the 1-1.
Misfires the long rebound secured by Enos. So it's going to be free throws from here on out for both teams as the Raiders have 16 fouls. Denneke down low to Holt, the double team. He's trying to swing it over to Bauer. And we're going to have, what, double dribble?
I think they're actually going to call a three-second violation inside the lane on Rapid City's Katrina Melgard. Got caught inside the lane, and a junior called for the three-second violation.
Two-point game in favor of the Cobblers. Raiders on offense. Let's have McLeod step to the outside and fire it. And it's a three! Margaret McLeod with nine! Raiders with the lead. For the first time since the first quarter. Central wants a timeout. 4:48 left to go. Coach DeBoer is a fired up man right now for the Raiders. He greets his team at half court. 1 point advantage. Raiders. Give you an update from the B tournament. They're early in the fourth quarter there at their seventh place game. Parker leads Edgemont 55-31. At the A, they're in the first period. And Vermilion leads Clark Willow Lake 9-3. And that's about halfway through the first period.
For the first time ever, Antiques Roadshow is coming to our great state of South Dakota. They'll be visiting Rapid City on July 14th. You can tune in this coming Monday to learn how you can guarantee yourself a place in line at this appraisal event. That's Monday night, 7 Central, 6 Mountain Time on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
7-0, the Raiders have outscored the Cobblers here in this fourth period of play. Wow, what a game we have had here so far. And Margaret McLeod, who left in the first quarter, who thought she was done for the day, has come back after scoring that early bucket with 7 points.
Yeah, you know what? Usually when a player leaves the game and gets hugs from the coaching staff all the way down the bench, that usually means their play for the day is done, but she must have talked their coaches into one last run here in the second half, and she's played like she doesn't want to quit. The senior wanting to go out in style here today right now on defense. Nearly got the steal.
It's off of the Raiders. McLeod is limping again. She has a stress fracture in her left foot. She's playing through the pain. It's been bothering her in the latter part of the season. Here's a three, no good, and McLeod secures another rebound. Claprot racing into the front court. Quinn thinks about it, stops and pops, it's blocked. And we're gonna get a pushing foul, and that's gonna go against McLeod, and we'll get free throws. Third foul on Margaret McLeod, the one and one the other way. LaCroix in, Cruz out for the Raiders. Field goal percentage 33 for Rapid City Central, 13 of 39. Stevens 13 of 38, 34%. And Holt misfires. Cobblers yet to score in this period. Stevens has scored 7 in this period to take the lead.
McLeod hardly played in the first half, leads her team in points and rebounds, and she's got 2 more, now giving Stevens a 3-point lead with 4 minutes remaining.
That's 11 points now for McLeod.
Yeah, 11 points, 6 rebounds today for Margaret McLeod.
Bauer missed it. Rebounding foul is going to be on Cheyenne Quinn. That's her third. Nice move by Bauer to get to the baseline, and quickly to the scorer's table is Missy Hertrick, the 6'1 freshman. And she will replace McLeod. Now, McLeod has checked out before. Will she come back in? Limping a little bit, but still seems to be moving fine, considering. Bauer ties it. That's the first point of the period for the Cobblers.
I know we've really been hammering this in, but I can't talk enough about the competitive spirit of Margaret McLeod today, playing with the stress fracture and being able to compete here in the second half. That's a true grit here on the floor today inside Frost Arena. You got to really respect what she's done today for her team.
We've seen some great efforts. Sarah Zirpel last night, 14 fourth quarter points to lead Washington from behind. Now McLeod just playing through the plane. Claprot misfires on the three. Quinn was fouled on the rebound.
Bauer can't believe it there from the left baseline. She went up in the air with Quinn. She was behind Quinn. And when Quinn secured the rebound, had a little bit of a shove with the body more than anything. Got called for the foul. That's her third, I believe.
Yeah, that's going to be on Lexi Jo Denneke. And the misfire by Cheyenne Quinn. She's stuck on 8 points. Denneke quickly the other way. Oh, near misfire there on the pass. Bauer lost it. There's a scramble, and Quinn ends up with it. Gives way to Cruz. She's got Hayes wide open. She gets it. The layup. Good. 3 points for Gabby Hayes. 3-point advantage, Raiders. Quickly up court to Carmichael. Melgard secures it, blocked by Hertzschert. Here comes Hayes, finds Claprot. She doesn't have the numbers, and she'll get it back. What a play by Hertzschert, the freshman, coming up big in the fourth quarter for the Raiders. Claprot can take her time. 15 on the shot clock. Quinn along the baseline throws it right to Denneke. Denneke weaves her way through traffic. Gets it back, fires the three, it rolls around, and Hertzschert had it, lost it, got it back, finds Quinn. I don't know, about 3-4 players had it and lost it there.
Man, if this is any indication of how today's going to go, we've got a wild championship Saturday in store for you here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. A timeout called by Rapid City Stevens. They lead right now 41-38 here with 2:04 remaining. We should remind you that South Dakota has another great show coming up here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. This great state of South Dakota has been called the land of infinite variety. The splendor and majesty of the state is in full blossom as South Dakota Public Broadcasting presents a unique bird's eye view called Over South Dakota. Catch it throughout the month on South Dakota Public TV. It'll actually air this Saturday, the 10th, at 4:30 p.m. Central, 3:30 Mountain Time, and again on the 11th at 1 Central, noon Mountain Time.
Update from the B tournament. Parker, the big advantage over Edgemont halfway through the fourth period of that seventh place game, 59-37. At the A tournament, they're just underway in the second period. Clark Willow Lake has come back. They've got a 1-point edge on Vermilion in that seventh place game, 13-12. Field goal percentage, 13 of 44 for the Cobblers, 15 of 41 for the Raiders. Turnovers, 19 for the Cobblers, 16 for the Raiders at this point. And McLeod back into the game for the Raiders. The starters say for Cruz on the court, LaCroix is in. She has the ball now. She's the only reserve on the court for the Raiders. They're trying to nurse that 3-point lead. 10 seconds on the shot clock. Quinn, oh, had the three, didn't take it. Now 5 seconds on the shot clock. Quinn will fire for three. Too strong, rebound into the hands of Denneke. Still a lot of time left, but the Cobblers are a good 3-point shooting team, and they're open, they'll take it. They've fired over 350 on the season. Bauer, blocking foul. Quinn, who can't believe it, that's her fourth. And I believe we're gonna have two free throws. Yes, double bonus time for Taylor Bauer. 3 points in the game, all from the free throw line. She's 3 of 4.
Central, 8 of 12 from the free throw line overall today, shooting right around 65% as a team. Stevens making about just under half of their free throws today, 6 of 13.
She got them both. It's a 1-point game with a minute 19 and counting.
35 turnovers between these two teams today. Kind of surprising it's actually that many. It's been a very physical game. It seems like both teams have ran their offense pretty well here today, but a big steal there and another turnover for Stevens.
Now 1 minute to go, 1-point advantage Raiders. Carmichael down low, and we're gonna have a steal by McLeod. Finds Claprod. She's gonna let the traffic pass her by and settle into the front court. 15 seconds difference between the shot clock and the game clock. A 1-point advantage for the Raiders. Coach Bloom in front of us saying no foul. They're gonna settle on their defense and hope to get a stop.
The good news right now for the Cobblers is there's about a 15 second difference between the shot clock and the game clock. Even if they do get a two here, they have a chance for the three and the tie at the end.
7, 6 seconds on the shot clock. Claprod into the paint. Feeds McLeod up and in. What a pass by Claprod. Timeout called by Central. What a drive and a pass to McLeod underneath by Katie Claprod. Waited till the last moment. The Raiders are up by three with 8.9 left.
And you might see there as McLeod heads to the left of your screen, she's hobbling big time right now for Stevens. This game taking a toll on her, but the true competitive spirit of Margaret McLeod, she got one last bucket there for Stevens. Now they're gonna have to decide if they wanna leave her in the game defensively or maybe bring in someone with a little bit more mobility, but she is such a dominating force inside offensively and defensively, you'd have a hard time taking the senior out of the ball game. If you're Central, obviously you've got to look for the three or get the ball inside, try to get the two and the foul, but either way, they need three here to tie with only 8 9/10 of a second remaining in this ball game.
Hitting three-pointers today so far, Chelsea Carmichael has knocked down 4 3-pointers. Regan Enos has hit a 3-pointer. The main shooters are Bauer at 40% on the season, Carmichael at 27, Denneke at 30, but it has been Carmichael who has taken the most 3-pointers on the season.
The inbound will come just in front of us here near the Cobblers bench. It'll be a half court set for Rapid City Central.
Denneke works to the baseline. They find Carmichael. She's got the three. Misfires. Rebound. Loose on the floor. This ball game is over. And the winner are the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens, 43-40. Carmichael had the good look at the shot, but it just wouldn't fall. And Margaret McLeod, 13 points in this game when we thought she wasn't going to come back and play. And she rallies her team to victory. What an effort by Margaret McLeod and the rest of the Raider team.
Nice moment there. You can see on the right side of your screen, Katie Claprod getting a big hug from her head coach, Donovan DeBoer, the senior, going out in style here today with a seventh place finish at the state basketball tournament.
An unbelievable finish down the stretch, those rivals. And it's the Raiders who come out on top, 43-40. Hopefully here in a moment we can get a word with Coach DeBoer. He's still talking to his assistants on the sideline here. What a game we have had for seventh place, 43-40.
Tell you what we'll do. Let's take a timeout here. When we come back, hopefully we'll get a chance to sit down with head coach Donovan DeBoer. We'll get you some final stats and more in a moment from Brookings as the AA Girls State Basketball Tournament continues right here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Activities Association Championship is brought to you in part by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, by Dakota Bank, and by Farmers Union Insurance.
All right, we're back here at Frost Arena. Steve Toom, J.J. Hartigan to my right side. To my left side is Coach Dr. Donovan DeBoer of the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens, a man who looked like he was out on the court playing himself. Coach, congratulations on the victory. First of all, I have to ask you, we talked before the game about Margaret McLeod's condition, and you said, well, she's going to start, she's going to try to go, and you figure the first time she comes out of the game, that'll probably be it. She got a lot of hugs and from yourself, from all the team. It looked like she was done. What changed to bring her back into the game?
Halftime. You know, that was my intentions all along, and we told her that, and you know, we kind of got all the emotion, I thought, out of it at our shoot around, and we took her out, and she felt like she was moving pretty good, and she kept talking to me on the bench, you know, coach, I think I can play. I said, Margaret, we made a decision, you know, I don't want you to be out there in pain, I don't want that to happen. And so we played, and I thought our young kids played pretty well. I mean, we needed to hit a few more shots in the first half, I think, but we had our looks. Then we went into halftime, and when a senior All-State player looks at you like that and says, coach, I want to play.
Wow.
How do you say no? I said, do you want to play or can you play? And she said, I can play. I said, all right, then you let me know when you need to come in and out. So that's what we did. She gave me signals, and our assistants did a great job of getting them in and out. And my assistant, Sherry Grisberg, she said at halftime, she said, coach, if your senior wants to play, you let her play. It's mm-hmm. just the way it goes. And we had a little discussion about that. And I guess she won over, or Margaret won over, one of the two.
Talk about your senior leadership, Katie Claprod, and what Margaret McLeod have meant to this team really throughout the entire year.
Well, it's really nice to have senior veterans, because, you know, there's just times where even in a seventh and eighth place game, seniors just dig down and they want it, especially for their last game. And you can see we've got three or four of the loose balls down here, and they weren't even jump balls, and I thought the officials did a nice job of letting that play out. And it seemed like we got every single one of them. Maybe we didn't, but it just squirted out, and all of a sudden we had it. And a lot of that this week has keyed off Alexis Cruz. Alexis Cruz isn't a scoring machine, but the kid's 5'1", maybe, has feet like, you know, size 4, youth. And she's everywhere. She's flying everywhere. She had 7-8 rebounds both of the previous two games. She had a couple this one. She's on the ground, and that's that senior leadership, that senior those senior guts that don't want it to end.
You mentioned when we were talking here, a key contributor off your bench was Kenla LaCroix. Talk about her game today.
Well, she just came in and hit some big shots when nobody else could make a shot, it seemed like. Mm-hmm. She came in firing. We had a discussion with our bench players saying, you got to be ready to play, you got to be ready to go. And she came in and she was ready. She's like, she was fearless. And a lot of juniors wouldn't take those shots, especially when you got four or five seniors that are busting their tails out there. They're just going to say, I'll let the seniors do it. But, you know, Kendra's put in her time, and some minutes, some games she plays a lot, some games she doesn't, but she's always got a positive attitude. She comes in, she does the work, and, you know, that's what happens when you do that.
Go ahead, JJ. Well, shooting in the second half, obviously just 6 of 22 there in the first half. You turn around 10 of 21 in the second half. Where'd that turnaround come from? What were the adjustments you guys needed to make there out of the halftime break?
Shots. I mean, we told the kids we wanted to run and run and run and attack. We couldn't let them just sit up there in that zone and pack it in and dictate what we wanted to do. We wanted to pick up tempo. A lot of that shooting percentage is because we got a few layups. When you get layups, your shooting percentage goes ways up instead of settling for threes, you know? So that's part of it. But the other part of it is we just had some shots go in. And our kids were still tentative to shoot it. I don't know. We haven't had the greatest shooting weekend. But, you know, we get to feel good about today. We won a game today. We're going to take home seventh place. And the seniors got to go out on a win. And I'm really proud of them for that. And I'm just proud of their effort the entire week. Our effort was there. Defensively, we played really well all weekend long. And sometimes shots just don't go in.
Coach, thanks for your time.
Well, thank you very much. I was glad I got to talk to you
yesterday. Yeah, we're glad you got a chance to talk to you, too. And have a safe trip home. We'll see you tonight here for the awards ceremony.
Yeah, you got it. Thank you very much. Thanks, guys. Thanks, JJ.
Congratulations, Coach.
That is Dr. Donovan DeBoer, the head man for the Raiders of Rapid City Stevens. What a victory today for his team. We'll take a timeout, come back with more. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Sports Championship is underwritten by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, and by Dakota Bank.
Welcome back to Frost Arena here in Brookings, Rapid City Central. And Rapid City Stevens played a doozy. It was won by the Raiders 43-40 for seventh place. And we'll give you an update on the B tournament. It's a final. Parker captures seventh place there, 75-51, with a stats recap of that amazing seventh place game. I'll turn it over to J.J. Hartigan.
Pretty wild way to end the ball game here. There was a three for Central to try to tie it at the buzzer, but it goes in and out, and Stevens gets the 43-40 win here today. Central finishes the day 13 of 45 from the field, shooting 29% as a team. Stevens 37%, 16 of 43 as a team today. Rapid City Central actually out-rebounded Rapid City Stevens 37-30, but it's Stevens who comes up with the victory today, led by Margaret McLeod, who had 13 points, 6 rebounds, was tied for the team lead in rebounds, led her team, and actually was the leading scorer in today's game, and her play in doubt throughout the entire day, but was able to stay in. Really a gritty performance for her. Her fellow senior teammate, Katie Claprod, 8 points today, 3 rebounds, 2 assists, 2 of 9 from the field, 1 of 5 from long distance, 8 points for Cheyenne Quinn. She was 3 of 12, just 1 of 6 from long distance today, but got 8 points today for Stevens. 6 points for Kendra LaCroix, 3 points for McPherson, and for Gabby Hafes, and 2 points today for Courtney Buck. For Rapid City Central, they were led in scoring today by Chelsea Carmichael with 11 points, 8 points apiece for Taylor Bauer and Grace Weeks, and 4 points today for Lexi Jo Denneke. 2 points on the evening for Katrina Melgard and for Reagan Enos.
All right, we're going to take a timeout and come back with more as Aberdeen Central and Sioux Falls O'Gorman warming up for the fifth place game. You're watching the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
This may sound like a typical high school basketball game being played on a Friday night in South Dakota. In fact, it's a crash course in cooperation and teamwork. It's a test of dedication, determination, and drive. It's character development in action. If you think high school sports are only about competition, think about this. High school sports can play a critical role in a student's overall education. In fact, studies show that students who participate in school sports are more likely to enjoy greater levels of achievement in their academic lives. At the same time, playing sports helps teach lessons not covered in the classroom. Lessons like tolerance, respect for the rules, and the importance of supporting your community. High school sports. a winning part of a complete education. This message presented by the South Dakota High School Activities Association and the South Dakota Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
And welcome back to Brookings, the site of the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament. I'm Steve Toome along with J.J. Hartigan. We're joined here at the broadcast location by Barb Walder from Brookings High School, who's one of the media instructors there. And she's played a big role in helping this tournament happen on television because a number of her students helping out with various stuff, camera work and other behind-the-scenes production work. And Barb, thanks for taking time to talk to us here today. So let's go back to the start of the process here. And your students have been involved before. And how far in advance before a state tournament do you start making the plans to get your students involved?
Well, actually, we start at the beginning of the semester. And prior to the year, we find out what events are going to be in Brookings, and then we kind of go from there, and we keep in touch with Brad Van Osdale, and we know exactly what events we'll be doing and what the students will need to know to do those events.
Now, have you had any shortage of volunteers?
No, we haven't. In fact, today, the students, we have about 22 students here that rotate throughout for the whole AA tournament. And this is their semester exam.
Ah.
So what a way to bring it all together, huh?
Yeah, how many people have the entire state of South Dakota witnessed their exam?
I don't know, but I know they're doing very well.
Great, great. Now, during the school year, are they involved with athletic or arts events as far as running cameras and doing other things, audio and video and lighting and anything like that?
Yes, our students stream all of our activities, our events that are athletic events at this time. We haven't done any of our other events like choir or band, but we have done all of the activities for the athletics.
Now, during a typical, let's say, week when there's basketball or and volleyball or football going on during the year, what do you do during the week to prepare for an event, say, on a Friday or Saturday night?
Well, there are lots of things that the students need to know as far as how to adjust the cameras. And when we get ready to, we go up and we show them where they will be stationed. Mm-hmm. And the students work very hard figuring out exactly what is needed. And a lot of the students, what I have found, have never been to an event, basketball game, and that would be their very first event. So we have to kind of go through a little terminology with them as well, so that they understand, you know, where the home bench is and the away bench and so on. But it takes time, and the students are really fast at picking up, you know, what they need to do.
Now, how many, are there specific classes that are offered by the school? Is there like a media studies class, or is this something that's all pretty much extracurricular?
Oh, no, this is a class. This is a business media productions class. And in that class, not only do they do these events, but they also work for the public. There are events that we go out and we tape for the public. We also do PSAs that we produce. Public service announcements, but working with South Dakota Public Broadcasting is our biggest event.
All right, Barb, thanks for taking time to talk to us today, and we thank their students for all the hard work they've been doing over the last several days.
Thank you guys very much.
It's Barb Walder from Brookings High School. We'll take a time out, come back with more. This is the Class AA Girls Basketball Tournament on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Activities Association Championship is brought to you in part by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, by Dakota Bank, and by Farmers Union Insurance.